welcome to worship with St. Paul's United Methodist Church of Mendota Heights, Minnesota. I'm Amy Jo Burr, the pastor of St. Paul's, and I welcome you to join our congregation in worship today as we consider how Jesus Christ is the bread of life. Especially, we welcome today our guest preacher, the Reverend Dr. Dana Scopatz. If you wish to join the people of St. Paul's in in-person worship in our sanctuary, on May 29th, we will be worshiping together at 10:30 a.m. Then on June 5th, the next Sunday, we will switch to a summer worship time of 10 o'clock a.m. And now, let us turn our hearts towards God and begin our service with prayer together. Loving God, we give thanks for this time of Sabbath renewal, when we can gather in your house to hear the word of God, be fed by the bread of life, and be strengthened by your Spirit. Bless us during this time of worship. Amen. Please join me in the singing of our opening hymn, Life-Giving Bread.
Transformed anew, and life-giving bread may be shared in our life with you. Coming together, we celebrate life. We are the people gathered as one, coming together with Christ as our head. Life-giving word to life-giving bread. Life-giving bread, as our hearts are transformed anew, and life-giving bread may be sharing a life with you. Tasting and seeing the goodness of God bids us to bless the Lord at all times. Tasting and seeing the fruit of the vine, life-giving joy in life-giving wine. Life-giving bread, as our hearts are transformed anew, and life-giving bread may be shared in a life with you. Called now to witness your love so divine, we are the branches, you are the vine. Called to be servants, called to become salt for the earth and light for the world. Life-giving bread, as our hearts are transformed anew, and life-giving bread may we share in a life with you.
A scripture reading from Isaiah 55. Hear, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters, and you who have no money, come buy and eat. Come buy wine and milk without money and without price. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread, and your earnings for that which does not satisfy? Listen carefully to me, and eat what is good, and delight yourselves in rich food. Incline your ear and come to me. Listen, so that you may live. I will make with you an everlasting covenant, my steadfast, sure love for David. See, I made him a witness to the peoples, a leader and commander for the peoples. Now you shall call nations that you do not know, and nations that do not know you shall run to you because of the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, for he has glorified you. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake their way and the unrighteous their thoughts. Let them return to the Lord, that he may have mercy on them, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return there until they have watered the earth, making it bring forth and sprout, giving seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes out from my mouth. It shall not return to me empty, but it shall accomplish that which I purpose and succeed in the thing for which I sent it. For you shall go out in joy and be led back in peace. The mountains and the hills before you shall burst into song, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. Instead of the thorn shall come up the cypress, instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle, and it shall be to the Lord for a memorial, for an everlasting sign that shall not be cut off.
Good morning! Today we are talking about the bread of life. For thousands of years, bread has been one of the most important parts of our diet. Bread comes in all shapes, sizes, and flavors. Bread is often baked into loaves, muffins, breadsticks, buns, bagels, and flatbreads like tortillas. We love to spread things on our bread too. Things like butter, jam, honey, cream cheese, and peanut butter. Most of us probably eat bread in some form every day. Bread has always been such a huge staple of what we eat that Jesus knew he could use it as an example to talk to us about God. As far back as Bible times, bread was very important to life. You may remember the time when Jesus fed a crowd of 5,000 people with just 5 loaves of bread and 2 small fish. And do you remember when Jesus taught his disciples to pray? He taught them to say, "Give us this day our daily bread." Yes, bread is and always has been a very important part of life. Bread tastes good, and when we are hungry, eating bread is a good way to satisfy our hunger. But guess what? Tomorrow we will be hungry again. And bread can provide vitamins and minerals to help us grow strong and healthy. But eating bread won't help us live forever. Wouldn't it be wonderful if there was bread which, if we ate it, we could live forever? Well, there is. Jesus called it the bread of life. After Jesus fed the 5,000 with 5 loaves of bread and 2 small fish, many people followed him. The only problem was they followed Jesus not only because of his teaching, they also followed him because he had fed them. Jesus said, "You come looking for me because you ate the loaves and had your fill." Then Jesus told them, "The bread of God is the bread that comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats this bread will live forever." Jesus is the heavenly bread that satisfies our hunger. He is the heavenly bread that gives us eternal life. Eat the bread that came down from heaven. Eat and live. Let us pray. Our Father, we thank you for sending Jesus, the living bread, that we might have eternal life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
A reading from the Gospel of John, chapter 6, verses 35 through 51. Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. But I said to you that you have seen me, and yet do not believe. Everything that the Father gives me will come to me, and anyone who comes to me I will never drive away. For I have come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I should lose nothing of all that he has given me, but raise it up on the last day. This is indeed the will of my Father, that all who see the Son and believe in him may have eternal life, and I will raise them up on the last day. Then the Jews began to complain about him, because he said, "I am the bread that came down from heaven." They were saying, "Is not this Jesus the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How can he now say, 'I have come down from heaven'?" Jesus answered them, "Do not complain among yourselves. No one can come to me unless drawn by the Father who sent me, and I will raise that person up on the last day. It is written in the prophets, 'And they shall all be taught by God.' Everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. Not that anyone has seen the Father except the one who is from God. He has seen the Father. Very truly, I tell you, whoever believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life. Your ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness and they died. This is the bread that comes down from heaven, so that one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats of this bread will live forever, and the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Good morning, everyone who is worshiping with us online. I am delighted to be here with you today, taking part in your online and later in-person services. I will admit that when your pastor asked me if I was available to preach this week, I almost said no. I knew it would be right at the end of two very busy weeks, and I wasn't sure I'd have time to do proper sermon preparation. But I really enjoyed being with you in your parking lot last summer, and I like to help out fellow clergy whenever I can. Since I'm teaching now rather than serving a church, I'm available on Sundays, and I owe a large debt to the retired pastors who helped me when I was a student pastor, who were always willing to step in when I needed them. So I decided it would be fine. I'd just pick from one of my very favorite scripture passages that I knew I'd have a lot to say about. And well, that's the other advantage of not preaching 50 weeks a year, is you can just pick your favorites. Unfortunately, that doesn't narrow it down as much as you'd think, because I have a lot of favorites, but not 50, maybe 50. I could probably go a year preaching only on my favorites, but then the bishop would have to move me to another church so I could start over. But anyway, one of my top 50 favorite Bible passages is the 6th chapter of the Gospel of John, which we read a piece of for today. Jesus uses a lot of metaphors to describe himself in the Gospel of John. A vine, a shepherd, a door, light, and this one, the bread of life. It confused the people who heard him, of course, as Jesus' metaphors and parables often did. What does he mean, the bread that came down from heaven? We know where he came from. We know his parents. How can he say he came down from heaven? And I love that rather than defending the idea that he came down from heaven, Jesus directs them back to the idea of bread, because it wasn't where he came from that he was trying to get across from them, or not just that, but what he was, is, something that is going to nourish the life of the world. Now, the point of a metaphor is to provoke thought. By linking one thing to something else, you see it in a new way.
And the metaphor of Jesus as bread really works for me because I love bread. I love the smell of it, the feel of it, the taste of it. I love the touch of bread dough, the way it feels stretchy and sticky, and yet your hand comes away clean. I love the feel of my skin after I've been kneading bread. I think I love the smell of rising bread dough even better than the smell of bread baking. There are few things in life I enjoy more than making bread. And there are also few things that I enjoy so much that I do less often. Baking bread takes time, lots of time. There's not really a lot of time where you're actually doing anything, but for 4 to 24 or sometimes 72 hours, depending on the recipe, you have to schedule everything else around the needs of the bread. Is it time to knead it, time to deflate it, time to put it in the pan, time to put it in the oven, time to take it out of the oven? Bread demands timing and attention. At the beginning of last summer, we bought a backyard pizza oven as a way to socialize more outside. And I'm looking forward to moving it back out of the garage soon and return to the routine of making bread every Wednesday, making dough every Wednesday to be ready for Friday pizza night. There's a comfort in routine baking. That's probably why so many people turned to baking during the initial months of the pandemic. When there's so much in the world that we can't control, here is the predictability of water, yeast, salt, flour. The church where my family worships, Faith UMC in West St. Paul, recently started a loaves and fishes meal monthly. It came out of a church planning retreat where we spent time discerning who we are as a congregation and what we should be doing that expressed that identity. We decided that we are a community where the good news of Jesus is taught and proclaimed, and that we help our members each to live into God's calling on their life. And one of our members felt very strongly the call by Jesus to feed our neighbors. So we all rallied around that, and now we have this new project going. I bring up our Loaves and Fishes project because it's sometimes too easy to spiritualize Jesus' message, which is what I'm about to do. Coming down from heaven and being drawn to the Father, and I will raise them up on the last day, makes it pretty clear that Jesus is not just talking about feeding people literal bread, or even metaphorical bread in the sense that every meal is referred to as daily bread, even if there isn't any actual bread involved. Our first two meals have been chicken. But before we talk about the heaven part, I think it's important to acknowledge that there are many places in the Bible that make it clear that God is concerned with literal hunger too, and that the followers of Jesus are to feed people, not as a prelude or a hook to get them in to listen to our message, but because God doesn't like people to go hungry. But Jesus is not literal bread. He is, he tells us, the living bread that comes down from heaven, that whoever eats it will not die but live forever, that in some unknown and perhaps unknowable way, when the life of Jesus becomes part of our mortal bodies, they take on the eternity of God. Whoever eats this bread will live forever, and the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh. I've been pondering that the last few days, where I had planned to come here and preach a lighthearted sermon about bread, maybe make a few dough puns. I have got dough puns, people. But instead, I've been pondering, whoever eats this bread will live forever, and the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh, in a world of school shootings. And trying to figure out, how do I bring a message to a church in a world of slaughtered children? And I think what we have as Christians here, what we have to do is to reach between the words, into the depths of the scripture, into the metaphor where words can't communicate. We're saying Jesus, we're saying bread, we're saying life of the world, and say that in there, what's happening is somehow Jesus is saying, that the creator of the universe, the God who stretched the heavens, who hung the stars, who started their furnaces burning, who pulled together atoms and molecules into planets, who breathed life into human beings and other animals so that we're walking around, that God, that divine power beyond thought or imagination, cares so much for each of us that he was willing to step into the world as Jesus, to become human, to become flesh, to give for the life of the world God's flesh. And that somehow, in a way that we don't or even can't understand, that when we become the church, the body of Christ, we take on some of that divinity, some of that eternity, some of that responsibility. We pray that on Communion Sundays, which this is not, but I'll remind you of that communion prayer. Make it be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. And so especially on days when we have these indelible images of blood, of torn flesh and blood, to remember that we belong to a God who steps into that, who comes into every bit of pain and fear, and who brings recreation, who brings that power that spun up the galaxies and calls us to at all times remember that and to be that, and that somehow, in ways that we don't understand, when we are willing to open our hearts to that love, to that power, to that God, we can nourish a hurting world. Amen. Please join me in a spirit of prayer as we pray together our community prayer. Living Christ, we celebrate your resurrection and praise you for offering us the gift of salvation. You are the bread of life who nourishes our souls. We look out upon the world with your eyes of compassion, and we pray today for all those who are hungry. May they be fed in body and in spirit. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For all who are injured or ill, may your healing renew their strength. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For all who are grieving, may your Holy Spirit bring them comfort and peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. for all who are recovering from addiction. May the power of your Spirit sustain them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For all those in need of shelter, may they find an open door of hospitality from your church. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Strengthen us with the bread of life. Transform our lives by the power of your grace. Empower us to shine your light brightly, and hear us as we pray together the prayer that you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
For today's generosity moment, I want to start out by saying thank you. Thank you for your thoughtful and continuous giving to St. Paul's United Methodist Church. And thank you for your generous Easter offering. This year, a portion of that offering is helping fund our current youth group project as they serve in mission, alleviating hunger and food security. In March, our youth chose a mission project for the year. After many conversations about what ways they like to go out and serve, we realized that a lot of their favorite mission activities is related to food ministry. So they set a giant goal of serving 100,000 meals by the end of the year. They plan to do this as many small mission projects, like helping out at Feed My Starving Children, participating in food drives, helping at the Union Gospel Mission, putting together every meal bags for Garlow Elementary, making sandwiches for the homeless, etc. And your financial giving is helping them to not only reach their goal, but overall helping them to feed the world, which is no small task. As of today, our youth group has served 14,163 meals, which is a huge accomplishment in itself. And this is only one project that is being worked on at St. Paul's right now. There are so many other good things happening at St. Paul's that your donations are helping fund. So again, thank you to all who contribute generously, both to the special calls of need and to the general ministry of St. Paul's United Methodist Church. Your generosity makes a difference in the lives of others. Let's bless these offerings by saying together a prayer of thanksgiving.
Almighty God, from you comes every good and perfect gift. We give you praise and thanks for all of your mercies. Your goodness has created us, and your providence has sustained us. Bless these gifts that we offer to you today, and bless our lives too, that we might live our thankfulness and loving service to you through Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen.
By your own hand be led.
Please join me in the singing of our final hymn, Here I Am, Lord.
I am the Lord of sea and sky. I have heard my people cry. All who dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save. I who made the stars of night, I will make their darkness bright. Who will bear my light to them? Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart. I, the Lord of wind and flame, I will tend the poor and lame. I will set a feast for them, my hand will save. Finest bread I will provide, till their hearts be satisfied. I will give my life to them. Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart.
And now let us go with the blessing of God. May the God of hope fill us with all joy and peace in believing, so that we may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.